So there we are. We're now on air. Okay, so what we're going to do today, we're going to, I guess, continue and develop from our exploration of Borges. So we studied Borges last week, and then you had the discussion in the seminar. So today we have a writer who is also a Latin American, who's also Argentinian, so he was a compatriot of Borges, but he belonged to a younger generation, okay? So he wasn't part of the Borges generation. Do you remember I said how Borges delighted in the idea that he had lived for just 1 year in the 19th century? So he loved that, that he was both a 19th century man, even if it was for 1 year, because he was born in 1899, and then he went through the 20th century with Cortázar. So Cortázar was born a bit later. So as you can see, so he called himself un niño bélico, and bélico is from war, because he was born the year in which the Great War broke out in Europe. So he's 15 years older than Borges. Okay, so that's interesting in the sense that he idolized Borges, and yet he became an altogether different writer, but you can always draw parallels between them. So he was born in 1914, and it may seem strange to you to see that he was born in Brussels, right? That is anomalous, because he was deeply Latin American and Argentine, although he would say that he was Latin American, so he saw a unified Latin American. He was a very left-wing writer, okay? So he was a socialist. If somebody came to me and said, okay, what are the differences between these two, between Borges and Cortázar, I would say it boils down to politics. One was a conservative, and one was a radical left-wing socialist. So we're with a socialist today. Although, having said that, Borges, when he was a young man, he was very much on the left. So I guess it's a little overlap. So he was, why was he born there? Why was he a baby of the war? Why was he in Brussels? Okay, so his family, so his dad was a diplomat, and he was posted in Brussels, so he was meant to be there for a short amount of time. So he was kind of accidentally born there, okay? And the family was, in a way, fixed to Europe, because they couldn't escape anywhere. They couldn't really go back to Argentina because of the war. So they retreated in neutral Switzerland, as many others would have done. So he grew up speaking French. He grew up bilingual. Do you remember Borges was bilingual, but with the Anglo? So he had the grandma from Staffordshire. Well, Cortázar was raised in a French-speaking country, and even as an adult, he still had a French accent in his Spanish. So he, for instance, couldn't roll up the R. And as you know, Spanish is a tough language to learn because you've got to roll your R's. So he couldn't do that, okay? He couldn't roll R's. So then when the war ended, so you can see the chronology, how neat it is. 1914 born, 1918 back to Argentina. So as soon as there was the armistice, then the family was desperate to go home again. So they went back to Argentina, and they lived in this lovely, you see this picture? This is a residential neighborhood. We are in Buenos Aires again. So Buenos Aires is the capital of Argentina. And we saw some of the Borges stories set in Buenos Aires. For example, the South, right? And there was all the underbelly of Buenos Aires. And I told you how Borges was enamored of these ruffians, of the tango dancing. So this is still Buenos Aires. This is a fairly, I mean, this is a picture which is now. So this is the neighborhood where he grew up. It's called Banfield. And Banfield is actually an English name, it's not really a very Spanish name. There's a reason for that. I'm not going to dwell on that. It's because of the British presence in Argentina at the time. But he grew up in this really idyllic, really lovely place. But there was tragedy from the beginning in his life. His dad, the diplomat, he somehow, for no reason whatsoever, left the family when the boy was about 5. And he just vanished and disappeared completely. So his mom had to fend for herself. And so he was brought up in a female-only setup because one of the aunts, when she knew of the situation, she decided to help. So him and his sister, so it was just the two of them. Do you remember, if you read The House Taken Over? Okay, so we've got brother and sister, the incestuous relation going on. It was just the two of them and the mum and the aunt. And he grew up in very difficult conditions. It was difficult for the mum to make a living. So from the very beginning, he was a very lonely child, and he always retreated in the world of the imagination. He absolutely loved reading, and that was his refuge. So he was a very, very bookish child. I'm not going to go through these for too long, because we can get more of an overview as I go along in conversation with the fiction, so that would be nice. So to look at the larger biographical context through the fiction. But what we can know is that he became a teacher. So he was a teacher in schools scattered all around Buenos Aires, so schools where, he said, for example, everything was delivered on a horse. So really isolated locations. And then he became a translator, and he taught, he translated the complete works of Edgar Allan Poe, whose influence is deeply carved out on his fiction. You can notice The Fall of the House of Usher and The House Taken Over. You can, the siblings, incestuous siblings. So you can see the parallels there. And then through political opposition, and I'm going to really touch on this later on, he decided to just leave Argentina altogether. There was an authoritarian movement. Came to Paris, loved Paris. It was a swinging 60s. And then, okay, we'll take over as we go along. So, Cortázar is intricately related to the fantastic. Borges is as well, although there's a slight difference between, apart from politics, between Borges and Cortázar, whereas Borges is more metaphysical. Do you remember we saw that? Intellectual. Perhaps that's a word. He's more intellectual. And Borges is concerned about the meaning of the universe. So you remember we touched on that last week, and we saw the idea of the labyrinth. So how he saw the labyrinth, not so much as a Cretan labyrinth with a Minotaur sort of centered in the middle, because that labyrinth is a labyrinth that goes through just one spiral and you enter to that kind of kernel of the labyrinth and you find the solution to the enigma, which is laying the Minotaur. Actually, his notion of the labyrinth is that it's impenetrable, and you will never find the riddle of the universe, okay? So you'll never get there. So the labyrinth in relation to Cortázar is probably to say, for Cortázar, the labyrinth is how we create structures of order in society which are evil. For him, society is wrong. So he hates rationality, he hates structures, he hates schools, anything that imposes order, he would be against that. So for him would be breaking that labyrinth and transcending order and to finding the essence of things, okay? So for him, reality is not our reality, it's a kind of reality that lies beyond what we know, okay? So that's how we would see, we could understand his fiction, and the fiction is in conversation with Borges. It definitely is. Okay, so how to interpret Cortázar? We can use the paradigm proposed by Todorov, which you studied, yeah? So Todorov is a Bulgarian critic, and who came up with this great idea. It's a kind of dualistic structure. He said, okay, we have a story, right? Such as, for example, the story, the letter to a young lady in Paris, which is a story that begins in a normal way. There's a man whose house sitting, there's a lovely flat, there's a lady who owns a flat, who goes on holiday to Paris and says, oh, would you do me a favor? Could you just look after my flat? And with a bit of trepidation, he kind of says yes, and then he's there, and he starts having, well, maybe delusions, or maybe not. Or maybe we have the intrusion of the supernatural. But one day he goes up the lift, and he's got a bit of a strange sensation. He coughs, he vomits a little fluffy bunny rabbit. Okay? And then the story takes on from there, and his anxiety increases. Why? Because he feels really, really uncomfortable in the house. It's too much habit. He's against habit. It's all too precious, it's all too polished, it's all too neat. So how do we interpret how do we read the rabbits? Are the rabbits a symbol or a metaphor for his anxiety and his idea that he's trespassing the order of this lovely woman who's now having a great time in Paris while the rabbits are trashing the apartment? Or are we to understand that, okay, there's a logical explanation to say, yeah, he's deluded, he has kind of, the rabbits are figments of his imagination to destroy that apartment, or that the rabbits are there because they're there? Because why not? If you can vomit a green horrible fluid, you could maybe one day vomit a rabbit. Okay? So just as Gregor Samsa would take into an enormous beetle. So it may well be. So that's what Todorov would propose. So he would say, okay, there's a tension. So you can either go for the logical explanation, the man is mad, or you could actually say, no, that there is a supernatural explanation, and you could give reasons for that supernatural. So that would be a way of exploring that. There's a great critic, I'm not sure whether I'm pronouncing his name correctly, Gyuko, who follows on the Todorovian model, but he kind of says that, well, it's actually quite similar, but he gives a bit more detail, and it's more kind of specifically related to Cortázar. But I think he dwells a bit more on this, on the fantastic. So what he's saying is that what Cortázar is trying to do is to transcend, as I was saying before, so transcend this reality. This reality for him is not good enough. He never liked the world as it is. So he's trying to just have a kind of a crack that opens it onto the reality we long for, okay? So, because that reality lies beyond the laws of physics, then our space and time would also have to fluctuate, okay? So if time in this reality where we are is linear, in the other reality would be cyclical, okay? And then space would also be, there would be like maybe simultaneity. It would be different as well, okay? But this is not a good, I mean, that other reality doesn't mean that it's a good reality. Because as you know, the story is ending horror. So what does that mean? Well, it means that the characters are dissatisfied with their lives and they venture onto other realities. And yet those realities cannot bring, cannot fulfill their desires and their dreams, okay? So, yeah, it's a tricky one. He was also, influenced by the French Surrealism. So by French Surrealism, I mean the cultural movement which was created by André Breton, and it was created in Paris. And of course, you know, Cortázar was in Paris at the time of the Surrealists. And Surrealism would be exploring, again, the irrational. So the Surrealists detested rationality, so like Cortázar. And they explored the world of dreams, hallucinations, sexual desire, and so on and so forth. So Surrealism, I suppose, meaning beyond reality, yeah? So transcending reality. Although, I mean, we all use the word Surrealist, don't we? We all use it in a kind of loose way. The way we use a Surrealist situation is when something is really strange, don't we? I'm sure everybody has used it. Well, actually, the proper Surrealism is a bit more nuanced and layered, yeah? Although Cortázar didn't want to be pigeonholed, he wasn't a Surrealist. But Surrealist elements can be identified, yeah? So to sum up, so Cortázar view reality is limited and one-dimensional. So his aim was to explore the other side of reality, that which had been annulled by rationality, yeah? Okay. So, how do we do that? So what he did is to conjure up everyday situations where quite gradually the supernatural intrudes and infiltrates. Okay, so it's like the story, the narrator who is coughing these bodies, it starts perfectly all right. You could recognize that as a slice of life. There's another story, for example, which is a brilliant story I recommend. It's called Bestiary, okay? And it's narrated from the perspective of a very young girl, so a girl who is going through puberty. And she is quite cruelly sent off by her mum. It's holidays, mum doesn't know what to do with this girl there. And she wants like free babysitting, so off, oh yeah, go with his relatives to a ranch in the countryside. So off she's sent to this house in the countryside. And in that house, where her relatives are, they have a tiger. But a tiger roams free through the house. And they, like, everyone is, all right, don't go to the living room, the tiger is there. So the tiger is like, you know, reclined happily. And so the family dynamics is all about the tiger. So all they do all the time is to tell each other where the tiger is and to avoid that room. And the girl seems to really dislike one of the characters. One of the grown-ups, who's an absolute bully, misogynistic. And she kind of has a plan to get him mauled by the tiger. So at the end of the story, she deceives this character to go into a room where she knows the tiger is. So she kind of murders this character. So, I mean, haven't things gone really strange from what I have been saying? The tiger, the narrator, the girl, mauled by... Okay, so that's Cortázar. Those are the kind of stories you would encounter. There's another brilliant story I would recommend, which is called Axolotl. And it's about a man who goes to an aquarium to just go, obviously, and see fish. And he becomes obsessed with a species of fish, which is called the axolotl, which is very unique, the kind of derived from the Mexican salamander. And he likes them so much, and he goes and he fixates them, watches them. Oh, one day he becomes one of them, and he finds himself trapped in a tank. Which he cannot escape. So there's the idea about, so I suppose if you go to that other dimension, so time would be cyclical, space would break up, and the self would become a hybrid. Because if you inhabit the two spaces, so if you move on to that other side, yeah, it means that you also undergo a metamorphosis. So you yourself would be subject to change. So hence the man becomes a sea creature Or the man in the letter to the lady in Paris, he becomes a composite of himself, and the rabbits who are his, so, I mean, the rabbits are his progeny, I suppose. They're his own creation. So I mean, any story I could mention, there's a story of a character who's got a new jumper, it's a lovely blue jumper, and he's eventually asphyxiated by the jumper. He puts it on, and then he can't take it off, and he's kind of devoured by the wool. How would you explain that? Actually, immersing in the jumper took him to that other, that other dimension. There's so many. I mean, I could spend a whole afternoon, but we need to move on. In terms of style, they're quite experimental, although unlike Borges, Cortázar doesn't use so much literary allusion. So as I said to you, they're less intellectual. They're written in a kind of conversational style. There's quite a bit of stream of consciousness in some of them, where we can hear the character's thoughts and mediated by a narrator. So you may have, depends on the stories, you may have some of that. And some of the stories, I'm not sure this one, so you've read Continuity of Parks, The Rabbits, House Taken Over. Most of the stories have the kind of superimposed realities, yeah? Okay, so to sum up, so for Cortázar, the system is evil. So people create structures and routines that stifle creativity and freedom, leading to alienation. So this applies quite nicely to the letter to a young lady in Paris, in the sense that this señorita, because that's the name of, that's how the original in Spanish is written, Carta a una señorita en París. So this is really a lovely lady, but she has imposed an order and a routine which disagrees with the narrator. And actually, I'm not sure whether you realize, it leads on to suicide. Because the letter which he writes is a suicide note to the señorita, letting her know that her flat has been trashed, completely destroyed, and that himself and the bunnies have jumped down the balcony, have committed suicide. Right. This is something you're not reading for the tale. But it's probably quite important to understand if anyone is keen on Cortázar. Every year I have a student who writes on Cortázar, or a few students who work on this novel. So this year I have a student whose dissertation is on games in literature. So this features very prominently. So this is his masterpiece, we could say. It's a novel which is called Hopscotch, and it follows the structure of the children's game. So I'm sure you've all played Hopscotch, by the way, is a kind of world game, and it appears in different variations, but it does follow the same structure, which is having the diagram, and you have to kind of hop, either with a little stone or with a coin, you hop from square to square of the hopscotch. This hopscotch, at least in my Argentina, which is the one he knew, has got a side which is called Earth and Heaven. Don't know whether the hopscotch, does it have that? Do you have that? Because so this one, you will start within Earth, then you will be jumping up because you want to reach Heaven. And those who reach, oh, you don't have that, okay. So I guess it's different in that sense. It's, I suppose, more transcendental, okay. So the book, it's a hopscotch in the sense that you don't read it from cover to cover, you don't read it in a linear way. Do you remember that Cortázar didn't like linearity, he liked circularity. So as soon as you open the book, there's a notice that says, okay, this book is many books, But above all, it's two books. One, you can read it in the lineal, boring way, banal way, which kind of you wouldn't recommend. Or you can read it in the hopscotch way. The hopscotch way would be the hopping from square to square, but you can hop backwards and forwards. So you create your own book, yeah? So it's a game for the reader, enabled by this kind of infinite structure. Do you remember the Book of Sand by Borges? Okay, this is its own Book of Sand, in the sense that it wants to capture an infinite experience, and a sort of fun experience. So obviously the recommended way is to play the hopscotch, and to do that. So, and again, like all of Cortázar's works, is structured on two different realities, one in Paris, one in Buenos Aires, okay? And it's about a character who is an outsider, solipsistic, who's really a bohemian, who goes around Paris, and who is completely dissatisfied, again, with life. So we see that theme recurring. But what's really interesting about the diagram and the idea of heaven is that he wants to reach heaven. And heaven, again, do you remember the idea of the labyrinth as well? Because, you know, a hopscotch could be seen as a kind of maze-like type of image and experience. So the heaven, isn't it the center? Wouldn't that be the center? Wouldn't that be the nucleus or the kernel of the universe, in the sense that if you get to the center, you will grasp that you were longing for, your dreams will be fulfilled, you will feel full, complete. So all he's trying to do, this poor character, is reach heaven, and of course he doesn't. It's really sad, okay? So this is recurrent, I think, in Cortázar, but the kind of profound dissatisfaction with things, which really was partly emanating from his own condition. So yeah, so it's quite sad, I have to say. But it's a brilliant book, I would really recommend. So when we move on to, I thought of all the stories, this was probably the one maybe worth elucidating in more detail. Not sure whether it is it somebody's favorite? See a show of hands? Is somebody's favorite? Not so much. Oh, the bunnies, you like that, didn't you? Yeah? Continuity of Fox? That was very short. Can talk about that as well. But I kind of thought probably this one we can tease out all these multiple levels of meaning. Okay, so plot line. So the incestuous siblings. Two siblings, very rich, we know that, and they inherit this mansion in downtown Buenos Aires, and they're so rich they don't need to work, okay? So they don't need to work, they don't marry, they don't have any children, and all they do is just sit around, they have all these hobbies, very, very strange hobbies, don't they? I mean, she, the woman, I think it's called Christina, she is like a Penelope figure, weaves and unweaves. So this is kind of, I suppose, mythological underpinning. And he, the man, he doesn't do much. He goes out, he likes French literature, he buys books. But they are within this routine. Okay, do you remember Cortázar doesn't like that? That doesn't like those kinds of routines. But what happens is that all of a sudden, the house is infiltrated by alien forces. Okay, so one day they're in their nice little routine, and they hear some noises, and they hear a kind of haunting presence. And they realize they have been invaded by an intruder, an interloper, mysterious creature. They don't quite know, but they very politely decide to leave those parts of the house to the alien powers. And they start locking doors. And of course it's a mansion, so it's not, to be honest, it's not that they needed all that house anyway. So they start, okay, so this wing is closed, that as well. And they end up just retreating to a tiny room, which is all they have left. Until one day they realize even that has been invaded. So they have no resort than to have to leave the house, lock the door, and just fling the keys into the sewer so that, well, likely nobody would go to a house that has been taken over. Okay, so that's the story. As a footnote, I should say that the story was published by Borges, because Cortázar was somebody who had been writing for a very, very long time, but didn't feel bold enough to publish because he was quite insecure. So Cortázar, by the way, was a very tall man. He was known as a gentle giant, and also he was known as a kind of Peter Pan figure who never aged. So he always looked incredibly young. And apparently he went to see Borges, because Borges at the time was a librarian in Buenos Aires who was publishing a magazine, so the kind of literary magazine was part of the library. So Cortázar just popped in, knocked on the door, took the manuscript of The House Taken Over, and Borges said, okay, I'm going to take a look at it, and I'll let you know within a week or so, or something like that. And by the time Cortázar returned to see what was going on, Borges kind of gave him a pat on the back and said, oh, your story is absolutely brilliant. In fact, look, it's been published. And he even had illustrations from Borges's sister, Nora, who was a painter. So imagine that. He was an unknown, a misfit, a total outsider. And then the best writer of the country had not only published his story, but even had illustrations of his sister. So it was dream come true. And then Borges, I think he learned later on that it was the very first story he published, and he said, I'm delighted to have been his instrument. So he was really happy to have helped. Okay, so going back, that was just a footnote. So going back to this, so who or what are the mysterious forces? Okay, so we can propose three explanations. Although none is conclusive, and they could be integrated. So they shouldn't be seen as entirely separate. Okay, so the fantastic one, okay. So Gyuko, the same critic who has been uploading the model, says that the siblings were expelled in a rite of purgation carried out by the house itself to cleanse itself of the immoral couple. Okay, so basically, these two siblings were so incestuous, they never got married, they didn't have children, so they were an abomination. So the house, because it was an ancestral house, didn't feel that it could have them there. Okay, so they were kind of expelled by the house. I suppose in relation to this, we could also read it in relation to the uncanny. Could be seen as a ghost story, yeah? Could be seen a bit like the film The Others. I know my colleague, I have a colleague called William Rowlandson, who, by the way, would have been giving this lecture for years. This is the first time I give this lecture. And he would say that to his student. He would say it's a bit like The Others. Which I thought was really interesting. And of course the Todorovian hesitation effect that will always be there. But there's also a political interpretation which I think is really interesting and worth dwelling on this, and I'm going to be doing this for probably 5 minutes or so. And this is related to, do you remember when I said to you that Cortázar was a teacher in these kind of ramshackle schools all around the country, and that he emigrated to Paris? You remember that? And I said, oh, it was because of the government, it was an authoritarian government, and there was indeed an authoritarian government. And the story may have been written as a reaction to the government. So we'll explore this in the next slide. But kind of related to this, you could explore a Marxist reading as class struggle, because you could see the siblings as aristocratic. They live off the land they own, so they're absentee landlords, yeah? So they own the land, and they have a life of comfort and leisure at the expense of the workers. So it could be seen as a kind of plantation economy. So you've got the plantation, you've got the fields. So the laborers, the marginalized, or the poor, the subaltern, are working on the land, and they do nothing, and they reap off the cream of the benefits, okay? So they could be seen as parasitical, who are taking advantage of the energy of others. So if you think about the brother, what the brother does is accumulate cash. So he's stockpiling cash, which they don't really need, do they? And the woman is weaving, knitting all these jumpers, which they never used. Okay, so she's got a pile. She's stockpiling, as people now are stockpiling on pounds of tins and toilet paper. They themselves were stockpiling with all of that, which does show that the story could be read as the class struggle. The point would be, those who are working are the intruders, yeah? Whether they are the peasants, whether they are the urban poor. And this connects with my political reading. And look at this. So, we can say that the intruder is the Peronista movement. Okay, so who are these people? So this is Perón, and this is his wife, Eva Perón, better known as Evita. Okay, so worth paying attention to this, by the way. So he was a colonel, so he was a bit of a dodgy guy, let's say. He was very sympathetic to fascism, so he came to power in Argentina in the 1940s. What was going on in the 1940s? Of course, it was the rise of fascism. He had been to Italy, had flirted with fascism, was a follower of Hitler, himself being a military, but for some reason, also, he was very charismatic. Well, of course, he was a populist. But there was a good side to him. So there was a good side and there was a dark side. So the good side was that he was a champion of the poor. Him and his wife, called Eva Perón, is a Cinderella story. So Eva Perón was very poor. She was an illegitimate child. She was born in a kind of far-flung place in Buenos Aires, and she rose to fame through her own endeavors, you can say. So she became an actress, and then she ended up becoming the first lady of a country. So it's a rags to riches story. Okay? We look into this soon. So Perón was charismatic, but he was a champion of the poor, and what he had done is to mobilize the working class. Okay, so he was anti-elite, he was anti-intellectual. So it's a bit like what's going on now politically, if you think the likes of Dominic Cummings, and in part the Brexit movement is a movement that is anti-intellectual. Yeah, in many ways, so you can see parallels, and the populism and the idea that there's some who have been left behind, because you know, the Brexit idea, I'm currently trying to be as impartial as I can in saying this. We have the north-south divide in Britain, and you've got that cleavage north-south. So you could say, I'm really sort of generalizing this so you can maybe understand, but don't take me too much at face value what I'm saying, because you know this is all complex. But you could say that certain people have been left behind. Blue-collar workers have been left behind. So in a way, at this time in Argentina, the urban masses, the poor, had been left behind, but he gave them power. And what they would do, they would go to the equivalent of the Houses of Parliament, and they would have massive rallies, and they would be idolizing these two, yeah? So I'm going to show you a clip that really exemplifies that. And this is a film that was made of Evita. There's a musical, not sure whether anyone has ever seen it. Has anyone ever seen Evita the musical? Nobody? There's going to be a version which is part of the Kent Musical Society, and it's going to be played on Saturday. So for many, I'm taking my students doing my Latin American module, so we'll be going there. We're actually studying Evita as part of this module. So there's a musical, and then there was a film version starring Madonna. Yes, Madonna. so I'll show you a clip of Madonna. But I think what's interesting about this is how it exemplifies the power of the masses. Yeah. So let's get the video. Okay, so I think I have amply illustrated what I meant by saying that the intruder was the Peronista movement, because what was happening was that this movement was anti-intellectual, was against the writer. So basically, if you were a writer at the time, you would be censored. So for instance, some of them had newspapers closed. For instance, Borges, whom we studied, was anti-Peronista. Cortázar was anti-Peronista. So what they would do, they wouldn't accept dissent. So they didn't like anyone who didn't follow the ideology. So to get rid of Borges, you know what they did? I mentioned he was working in this library. So as a joke from the regime, they promoted him to the, what was he called? So he was promoted, sorry, just to get the right title, inspector. He was promoted to the role of inspector of chickens and rabbits, and obviously promoted. So he had to resign from his job in the library, and he ended up doing something else. One of his friends, whom we studied in world literature, Vittorio Campo, was in prison. So she was in prison by the regime. Borges' sister was also in prison. And Cortázar, at the time, saw these urban poor who congregated all around the city, who'd be chanting Perón, 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 chanting all these songs, though they were the intruders who were encroaching on those who were the bourgeoisie. So he was, obviously, he wasn't mega rich, but he was a cultured guy. He represented the opposite of what these rallies had inculcated. So that's the other reading, that the alien forces, the intruder, are the masses who had taken over the city, like people like him couldn't walk around the city. Okay, having said all these, it was good, looking back, that the workers were given a voice, right? Maybe not in that way, maybe not in a kind of populist sense, in that they were the puppets of Perón and Evita, that were idolizing them as leaders. So you have the kind of personality cult, which is very dangerous. But somebody like Cortázar, many, many years later, after the Cuban Revolution with Fidel Castro and Che Guevara and so on, then he realized that some aspects of the Peronista Revolution with Evita was a good thing, brought social progress and mobility. So that's why there are two sides to Evita as well. So you have Evita as the saint, as the icon whom you see in that balcony, which is kind of embracing the poor. And you've got the other side of Evita, which is vilified as authoritarian, opportunistic, and somebody who wanted to arouse these kind of feelings. So you've got the two sides. But it's an interesting reading. If anyone is planning to write on the story, you don't necessarily need to dwell on the political reading. You could just perform the fantastic reading and then use the secondary criticism provided by Gyurko. Do you remember that critic with a very difficult name to pronounce? And you can also use Todorov, right? Or you could dwell on the political and the fantastic. So I think really it's up to you. Which way you go. Okay, so just to conclude, so what we get in Cortázar overall is a metaphysical exploration of reality, less intellectualized than Borges, so he's got his own concerns and metaphysical exploration. So Borges was more about understanding what reality is and realizing that it was incomprehensible and the denial of this reality, to say, okay, nothing exists unless we dream it. With Cortázar, it's slightly different in that we have to transport ourselves to the other reality. So in Cortázar, there's always two. Whereas with Borges, one annuls the other one. So the fantastic cancels out. Whereas in Cortázar, you always have the two of them, yeah, in perfect tension. So the stories explore these kind of fissures in reality, transporting into new dimensions. So that these alternative worlds offer revelations, but generally, I would say, end in failure, tragedy, or nightmare. So if you think the man, the rabbit man, commits suicide, the house taken over, the siblings are evicted, they're out in the street with nothing at all. In the continuity of Parks, we have the reader who is engrossed reading this novel in that lovely velvety green armchair, and he is actually stabbed by a character of the fiction which he's reading. So the character encroaches into reality and stabs him. Okay, so they all have a twist, and I think Cortázar was quite a master of that twist in the story. And generally, the characters are alienated. So the reason why they kind of reach out for a fantasy world is because they feel the world is not good enough for them, and they feel deeply alienated and deeply dissatisfied. So hence, they move on to these other realities. So I think that's pretty much everything. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. All right. Oh, let's turn this off.